This is a Choppin' It Up show brought to you by The Marching Podcast. And now here is your host, the Phantom Podcaster himself, Joe Beard.
To the Choppin' It Up show, everyone. I'm your host, Joe Beard, and happy to be of service for you. This podcast is for the second part of October, and we're ready to give you another great interview. We appreciate all those listening, whether through iTunes, YouTube, our blog, our website, Facebook, Twitter, or wherever you are on the interwebs. At the end of the broadcast, if you decide you like the show, then we appreciate a donation to the network, if you feel so in your heart, of course. Just simply go to themarchingpodcast.com and click on the donate button to help improve the show and help build our scholarship fund. This podcast is brought to you by Block Band Music and Publishing, BlocksUsUp.com, and SAY Marketing and Promotions. We hope you enjoy the show. All right, everyone. Lots of folks ask how to follow and how to catch up on all the shows. You can go to our website and click on the Listen and Follow tab. You will see a link to each one of our channels on Blog Talk Radio, our studio, and also on YouTube and our blog. Our blog is also a good place, and that is blog4.themarchingpodcast.com. When logging into our blog, make sure to put your email at the top right corner of the page so that you can get an email and other notifications when we release each podcast. We are on Instagram, posting the text of our episodes there, and we're also on Snapchat. Hit us up at Marching Podcast and send us a chat about our show or our blog, and we will respond on the podcast and give you a shout out. We also have a wonderful opportunity to broadcast the 90 Degree Show on NBC Sports. We actually have a green light, and we will be starting October 23rd at 7 p.m. Pacific Time. That's 10 p.m. Eastern Time, 9 p.m. Central Time. The Marching Podcast will be broadcasting the 90 Degree Show on NBC Sports over the national airwaves. And we still need some money to reach our goal, so make sure you go to the website and hit the donate button to give your financial support. In this podcast, we chop it up with Elijah Thompson. Elijah just finished Jackson State this past fall, and his last season marching in the boom was in 2016. We interviewed him for the Alcorn game, a.k.a. the Soul Bowl, but so many things have happened from last November. So we called him in the spring while he's been involved in other projects, and we chopped it up with him to catch up on how he was doing. And we are ready to finally put out this podcast. Elijah marched trumpet in the band, so that makes him part of the Royal Order of Trump Funk, and also Echoes of Hell, like me. So shout out to the Young Funk out there representing, because he's been a busy guy since last fall, and we want to finally give him his time to shine. So the first two parts of the interview are about Elijah marching in the band last fall, and a new announcement, the last two parts of his experience after graduation, we talked to him, and this is our beta version of our Choppin' It Up 2.0 interviews. We will be conducting interviews with people that you have talked to before in the past, or we have chopped it up with in the past. And the 2.0 interviews are an update to check on how these people are doing. We have a lot of folks we've been interviewing for the past 6 years, and we've kept up with all of them. And we want to make sure that everything is, we want to make sure that all of the listeners are listening and up to date with everything these great people are doing. So shout out to everyone that has done a Choppin' It Up episode, and you guys will be hearing more about that in the future. So in this podcast, in our first segment, we talk about the Alcorn game from 2016, which was his last game marching for the Boom. We also talk about band practices today. How long does the Signing Boom practice every night? We also talk a little about the football team and how he felt about their performance during his tenure there at Jackson State. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at marchingpodcast, or follow our blog, blog4.themarchingpodcast.com. You're now here with the Marching Podcast, and always glad to have some really good guests. But had to answer and bring in one of the Young Funk to talk about the Jackson State Alcorn game, a.k.a. Capital City Classic, a.k.a. Soul Bowl, a.k.a. Crossing Game, and a whole bunch of other stuff. But Mr. Elijah Thompson, what's going on today, man?
Hello, hello. Everything's all good on this end.
Well, that's what's up, man. Really glad to have you on the show. Shout out to you because Elijah, the Young Funk, is also one of my PlayStation friends. So we got to get on. We got to get on and do something sometime, man. But I see you on there. You be playing a basketball. You know what
I'm
saying?
All I play.
Okay. That's what's up, man. I just got into the basketball. So yeah, we'll definitely have to talk about that. But I wanted to. Okay. Also talk to you too, because this was you finished up your fourth year marching, so congratulations with that. I saw your picture on Facebook, you know, giving a shout out to your CBs and everything. This is actually also too, you are actually the first Trunk Funk member on the show actually talking about the show while you're playing, so wanted to, you know, make sure that we establish something so we can get the Young Funk on the show a little bit more. But thanks a lot for being on the show, man. So, one, I want to ask you, now, Alcorn, that's usually a big game. What was your initial reaction once you guys marched into the stadium, knowing that this was going to be your last performance there in your career?
The reaction is typically the same for every game. Once you see that the other band across the field, total annihilation is on the brain.
Right.
Kind of always got to go in there and handle business and beat Jackson State. You know, Trump Funk this year, we got a little chip on our shoulder. So that's always on my mind. You know, we really got to go out there and represent. Definitely an experience thinking back on all the Alcorn games. My freshman year, we played Alcorn at their stadium. So to end it all where it started was real cool.
So what was your crab year when you guys played Alcorn at their stadium?
2012.
Okay, so I'm trying to think. I guess, was that the first year that they dismantled the Capital City in Jackson?
Well, no, it's still the Capital City Classic, but it's in Jackson.
Okay. Because I remember, like, every year it would be in Jackson, and then we would alternate who was home and who was away.
Oh, see, no, I don't know. It might have been. That's possible.
Oh, okay. Oh, so, yeah, you younger. So, yeah, back when... I think it was like 2011 or 2012. It was the first year that they started, and like the Boom for like the first time in I don't know how many years went to Alcorn. So that might have been your crab year.
Yeah, I think it was 12, because in 11 they played at Jackson.
Okay, so yeah, that had to be. And I think I did a show then, because that was around the first year I started doing the show. And I remember we did a show talking about goodbye to the Capital City Classic, because all the Alcorn folks was complaining about going to Jackson every year and making sure that they got their money there and, you know, Alcorn and all that stuff like that. So that's when all that popped off. So you were the first band there to play there at Alcorn. What do you think about playing at Alcorn Stadium?
I just remember that first year. 0-0 hit, did the call or whatever, and we looked at the clock, and they set the clock to 90 minutes. And we was just like, why would they set the clock to 90 minutes? And we played until 0-0-0. And that was That was awesome. I enjoyed it. I kind of like their stadium. It's a little bit smaller, but it's not many stadiums where bands see each other like real face to face. And so that's always a good match. It's a better. I just think that's a better matchup. You know, face to face audience.
Yeah, I haven't seen it. I ain't gonna lie, man. I don't even think I've ever been to Lorman myself. So just know all of the jokes people say that it's like you just like in the force and all of a sudden you just see signs that, you know, it just said.
One way in, one way out.
Right. That's crazy. So that's cool that you had a good time actually going up in the event. What was your reaction from seeing them in the fifth and the zero and after they went on the field, you know, did the halftime show? What did you think about Alcorn's performance?
Well, there was a lot of hype being built up by Alcorn this season. I checked out a few clips. This whole season, they've been pretty consistent, and they had some good arrangements. So, you know, just seeing them in person, it wasn't as much as I expected, but from remembering what I saw in 12 to now, it was like, wow, you know, they holding it down. You know, I go back and watch the clips, and it's like, yeah, man, Alcorn hanging in there, okay. Yeah, I was pretty impressed with Alcorn. They've definitely stepped that game up a lot. But, you know, the boom got to be the boom, and we handle business.
Right. Yeah, that's what I noticed, too, is, like, they've been getting better over these last, really, 4 years, like, since you've been in there. They've since they've consistently got better. So how did you think that the boom did?
You know, we show up, show out, whatever. That's the expectation now. That's the standard. So, you know, we definitely handled our business. And, you know, I didn't even realize we were that small that we had lost that many people from last year. I'm just like, wow. The sound definitely hasn't changed. That just goes to show, you know, we work really hard and put in that time, put in that work, work on fundamentals and all that stuff. And it's just a good feeling to see the product, the finished product, when it's all said and done.
Yeah, man. How many people did the boom lose from last year? Because I know it's always, we always start out with some at band camp. It's always like 250, 300. And then at the end, it's like low twos, high, you know, 180 or something. Oh, what the number? Do you know the numbers this year?
Sure, we had around 310, 315 around that. This year, we only had like, I think, yesterday we marched with like 196, maybe, if that many.
And you think it's just folks? Well, I mean, I'm sure it's a lot of things. I'm sure we can sit here and talk a lot of things on why.
It's a lot of hard work. A lot of people did just end up just quitting, honestly. Some, you know, the band not for everybody. And some changes had to be made, you know, for the betterment of the program, kind of get some people out of there who wasn't really handling their business type stuff. But honestly, as you can see, not the band is smaller, but the product is man. I think some good important changes were made, and that's really this is only going to set us up for the future. And I can definitely see 300-400 piece boom in the near future.
Yeah, that's what's up, man. Because I've noticed, like I don't know, like you say, like I don't notice like the numbers. I just hear the sound, and y'all still coming with the loudness, because Jack State is loud now, man. Like, over the years, they'd have made them adjustments with the mellows and them baritones, man. So it's, yeah, man, it's crazy now, man. It feels good to see it, especially to look back and see that, you know, your band is still doing well in the streets. I gotta ask you, man, how long are y'all practicing? Do y'all still practice to like midnight and still like late into the night?
It's real interesting because my freshman year and my sophomore year, yeah, them times we used to practice till 1-2 o'clock in the morning type stuff. But now, it's crazy. The band has gotten really a lot more efficient. So, and some days we get out of practice at 8:30, and you know we've learned the whole field show and learned the whole 10 songs. Typically, practice gets out around 10 o'clock. But most nights, we don't even need that much time to do everything we got to do.
Okay, that's good because, yeah, I remember my pops, he marched the was in the band, and that was the thing that he didn't care to hear about was that we were practicing so late. And it's a trip because, like, being in the band, you don't even really notice that it's going on that long. So do you guys still start at 6 o'clock?
Nope, we start at 5:30 now.
Oh, wow.
Well, 5:20 now, actually.
Oh, wow. So y'all getting in there, I guess, getting warmed up so you can be ready by 6 o'clock probably, I guess.
Yeah, because, you know, the president, and times have changed, all the stuff that happened in 2011. A lot of things are changing. They actually cut our practice hours. So we're forced to be done by 10:30, I believe. So we got to start practice much earlier so we can make sure we have enough time to do what we have to do.
Did somebody get in trouble in 2011?
Robert Champion stuff.
Oh, okay, okay.
Whole atmosphere of bands changed, so folks weren't having that late practice stuff anymore.
Right. I really got used to that. I mean, I just adjusted to it, and partly too because I was all a band head anyway. Like I had issues because I went down to Jackson State to march in the band. So, but yeah, I was just saying that, you know, I just used to being in practice out all night. Okay, that's what's up. Did Jackson State win the football game?
I wish.
Oh man, damn, they lost to all corners. So was the football team, I guess, just speaking from when, since you were in the band, how did the football team look this year?
It was bittersweet, I will say, because the football team wasn't as bad as we were last year or the year before, but I don't know. We they were having some problems, like actually finishing the season. Like, we've been blowing big leads all season, and I just don't understand it.
Wow, yeah, because I know it's a new coach. I know the new coach there, it was his first year there. So hopefully, yeah, you know, he, you know, was doing something.
So he recruits and get some heavy hitters in there. We'll see.
Yeah, because it's been a minute since Jackson State been, since, you know, it's been, I don't know, but I guess about like 10 years. I think 07 we won the SWAC.
We went to the SWAC the back in 12 and 13, but we lost both times.
Oh, that's right. That's right. That's right. I forgot all about that. And we, do we lose the Southern both years? Or, oh, no, it was UAPB
oh,
12 one
was
year.
Pine
Bluff,
yeah.
Yeah.
12 was Pine Bluff. 13 we lost to Public.
Yeah, I think, and then one of them was on TV, too. And we lost, like, at the end, I think.
He got caught the bounds.
Yeah.
That was all over ESPN.
So y'all, and you were there seeing all that live then.
Yes, I was, and that was heartbreaking.
Fan directors, have you ever found yourselves in this situation? Showtime is quickly approaching. Your budget is quickly disappearing. Your music choices are narrowing. The equipment condition is wearing and your stress level is mounting. Stop what you're doing and contact Block Band Music and find out how we've got you. Check www.blockbandmusic.com, providing music, equipment, gear, and accessories to show style, core style, and traditional bands worldwide.
This is Chris Jones, owner, creator, and founder of March Aerobics. I'm just chopping it up with the Marching Podcast Network. Now get your sticks running.
We're back, everyone. What I remember most from the first segment was that Elijah's crab year was 2012, and that was the first year that the boom went back to Alcorn Stadium. It was always the Capital City Classic, and we alternated home and visitor with Alcorn, and I remember switching sides in the stadium with them every year. I remember in 1998, we were on the visitor side, and Alcorn wanted to take over the stadium and basically act as if it was their own because they were the home team that year. And after the game in the fifth quarter, they would not leave the stadium. Back in the 90s, that was considered the deciding factor in the fifth, was when the first band was leaving. Or, you know, whoever didn't have any more songs and the other band left first. That's what decided the fifth back in the day. Well, Alcorn would not leave this particular night. Basically, they were going to do what they could to get us out of that stadium. And I remember it was really, really cold and the band squished together so we could all keep warm. But Alcorn was not leaving. And I am not going to lie, some of us wanted to go. We were like, oh, man, just give it to them, man. They Alcorn, man. Let them have this year. I remember Dr. Magruder,
Shout out to the bruh. Shout out to the bruh. Dr. Magruder, he said, we can't leave, y'all. We got to handle our business, and we've got to defend our stadium. We can't let Alcorn have this battle. So eventually, we basically got so tired, we just started a chant, take your beep home. And it was, take your beep home. And of course, we wasn't saying beep. And we kept playing back to back, not allowing them to play anything at all. So thank the Lord, they finally left the stadium, which was a good memory, but something that I'll never forget when we were talking about Alcorn versus Jackson State and the whole Soul Bowl thing and just switching sides. They now get a chance to go to Alcorn Stadium. So shout out to class of 98. They were some soldiers. This was also the first year that I started to do the podcast in 2012. And I remember we did a show called Goodbye to the Capital City Classic. And I'm happy for Alcorn because they were able to do that. When you looked at the situation, they were always saying, hey, our school's not getting so much money. Our local businesses are not getting so much money. It's all going to Jackson. And I'm glad that they were able to switch that up. You heard like Elijah said, it's still the Capital City Classic when it's in Jackson, but then it's the Soul Bowl when you go out there to Alcorn. Had a really good conversation about this back in August of 2012, and it actually turned out to be a two-part podcast. So you can go on our website and find it, but it's actually quicker if you just Google the Marching Podcast, Goodbye Capital City, and you will see it there at the top of the page. So in our second segment, we talked to Elijah about the band staff there in 2016 and what he felt about them. We find out his most memorable experience marching with the Boom. We find out where he's from and what high school he went to. And he tells us the difference between the two and also how it was the same. And we find out his favorite games of last season in 2016. And he tells us why the Boom only marched 4 drum majors last year. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at marchingpodcast, or follow our blog, blog4.themarchingpodcast.com. How do you feel about the band staff? I know personally Lowell and I marched together. So it's good seeing him, somebody I know specifically. How do you feel about the band staff over these last 4 years?
Man, those guys are great. For real. Those guys are great, man. They, especially Mr. Little and Mr. Hollinger, some young guys. They really love the Boom. They've really done a lot to ensure that we kick butt every week for these past few years. You know, Mr. Hollinger, he was shaping the sound, and Mr. Little, and Mr. Little's been passing out some really kicking butt arrangements. Those guys are all-star team, honestly.
What has been your most memorable experience there over your last 4 years marching?
Man, so many. But, of course, I always got to go back to my freshman year. The Southern game of my freshman year was on my birthday. Me being a band head coming to Jackson State, seeing Southern for the first time, like, directly across the field. And, you know, I'm in the Boom. I mean, when I came back to my room, I just sat there like, wow. You know, this is what I've been watching these clips for years, and now I'm in it. That was definitely one of my favorite moments of being in the band.
Now, are you from Atlanta?
Yes.
What high school did you go to there?
The Great Southwest DeKalb.
Oh, so you from the actual Southwest DeKalb. So, man, it's a lot of people from Southwest DeKalb. Marshall.
Sure.
Yeah, my crab brother. I don't know if you knew.
The man, Aussie?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, you know Fufu there.
Fufu.
Yeah, man, that was my crab brother. What would you think was the major difference, like marching between? Because you went to two major programs now. What was the difference? Would you say like marching in Southwest DeKalb, and then marching in the Boom?
Well, and a lot of people ask me, you know, because you know the style of Southwest has changed since you know back then when Fufu was around, the style was. We had James Berry on staff then, and he's, you know, Jacksonian. You know, of course, Ms. Brown has always been at the Feeder Middle School at Chapel Hill. Ms. Natalie Brown, she is also a Jacksonian.
Okay.
And, you know, Southwest was a lot more aggressive then, more like a Jackson State kind of aggression then. And now it's a lot, I don't want to say FAMU's not aggressive, but it's more of a FAMU type style. Like, you know, we march like FAMU and play FAMU's music. So coming from there and coming to Jackson State, but at the same time, I'm a band head, so I love this. Mm-hmm. I came in, you know, we playing. I got 5 on it and all the stuff I used to watch on YouTube, and I lost my mind. But, of course, the playing styles are way more different. We play a lot more aggressive here than I did at Southwest. But do give props to Southwest. That's why I definitely improved on my horn a lot. My band director, James Sater. I will say the discipline and the maturity was definitely something that I kind of got from both programs. Mm-hmm. And that's, I can tell that's something, that's definitely something you have to have a great band. My high school's real good. And got to Jackson State, and it was like nothing changed as far as the behavior or how you treat Dan in general.
Yeah, man, that's what's up, man. What was your favorite game of this year?
This season?
Yeah.
Man, I don't know, man. We had a lot of good games. I'll say not necessarily for the battle, but the camaraderie between the trumpet sections. I had a lot of fun at Alabama A&M because we got a trumpet group, man. We were talking back and forth to those guys, you know, communicating, telling, they was hanging over for dear life on the trumpet. That was real fun. Man, Alabama State was a good game. Auburn was a good game. So, of course, the Southern game is always a good matchup. Really, I mean, honestly, I really liked every game this season. We were pretty consistent throughout the season.
Yeah, you were. The boom was really good this year. Right quick, so I just thought about a couple things. What happened to the fifth drum major? Why is dude calling it the J4 all of a sudden?
It's only 4 drum majors now, and I mean, it's not like no special reason or, you know, anything for that. They just decided to pick 4 drum majors.
Oh, okay. Do you think they're gonna have 5 next year, or is it just, they just gonna keep with 4?
At this point, I think it's more so of just who deserves it or who's earned it. If 5 people haven't earned it, then it is what it is.
That's actually a really good answer.
Shout out to Trump Funk and EOH, all that. Definitely congrats to the freshmen of this year who successfully completed the season in the program. And just look forward to bigger and better things from the band staff, from the boom. Trump Funk especially. We've been working real hard, so just be on the lookout for us.
Hello everyone, this is Joe Beard from the Marching Podcast. Is your school, club, or organization looking for high quality decorated apparel to outfit your students, staff, club, or team? Tired of the same old boring white t-shirt? Are you in charge of the upcoming fundraiser or special event but don't really have time to troll the internet for ideas or compare products? SAY can help with design and product selection. We can even assist with ideas on conducting an effective fundraising program. SAY can help you save time and get your message heard. So call 1-800-975-3156. That's 1-800-975-3156. SAY Marketing and Promotions.
Give your brand a voice.
Hi. This is David McFadden, Jackson State University graduate, Sonic Boom, Trump Funk, Fab 97. You are listening to Choppin' It Up here on the Marching Podcast Network.
We're back, everyone. What I remember most from the second segment was he really appreciated his band directors. He brought up Roderick Little, and he also brought up my man, Lowell Hollinger, who I marched with back in 98. Lowell's crab of 1998. Super proud of him, and if anyone is listening, you guys go ahead and make Lowell the head band director there of the Sonic Boom of the South. I love me some Dow Taylor, and I had him for music appreciation my freshman year. Thankful for him and thankful to him for asking us what grade we believe we deserved in his class, because a brother was struggling in music, like I told you guys. He gave me a C, so thank you, sir. Because I survived, if you will. And we interviewed him as well with our very own Renee Baker when they set up the Sonic Boom Alumni Association. So you can Google Choppin' It Up with Renee Baker and listen to that interview, because Dial Taylor is on there as well.
But yes, if anyone is listening, give Brother Taylor a break. And just go ahead and give Lowell the job. He's young and has time to grow and be there for a long time. Just like the Steelers did with Mike Tomlin. And just like the Rams did this year with Sean McVay. If you got a young guy who's full of potential, then go ahead and give him the reins. And he actually has some time to grow with the tradition. So really pulling for you, Lowell, because I know you deserve it. In our third segment, this begins our beta 2.0 interviews for Choppin' It Up, where we start to choppin' it up with people that we have talked to before in the past, and we check in on them and see how they're doing since our last conversation. Our first official 2.0 interview will be with Gregory Jane DeBrus, Director of Athletic Bands at Penn State University. We check in on him to see how the job is going. For Elijah, we caught up with him this summer. He tells us what his major was at Jackson State, and he talks about two major events that he was a part of after he finished marching in 2016. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at marchingpodcast, or follow our blog, blog4.themarchingpodcast.com. After the Alcorn game, I know we talked about your last game and last experiences and all that stuff like that. What did you pick up doing now in that spring semester after the Alcorn game?
I actually graduated in December, so pretty happy about that. I actually majored in computer science, so I have a degree in computer science. I got home, had a few interviews, and that field didn't go so well. Next thing you know, I get a call. The director at Drumline Live, which is like a national stage performance that depicts HBCU culture and marching bands, and give me a call saying, man, we would love to have you on the tour. And so I was like, man, you know, like, it was an amazing opportunity. So I went on the road with those guys for about 3 months, traveled all across the country performing, really fun, heck of an experience, traveling across the country, got back home. Now I'm back in my field now in computer science doing some software development. This summer has been real busy. Actually, this was our second year now called the Georgia Mass Band, which is like a summer all-star band here in Georgia. And it was actually really successful. Had over 100 people come out, did a few battles, had the first ever virtual band battle where we battled on Facebook Live going back and forth and at the same time. That was pretty cool. Right now, man, I'm just in my field right now, enjoying life, appreciating all the opportunities, and really just enjoying myself.
Okay. So you brought up Georgia Mass Band. You brought up Drumline Live. You brought up, the virtual battle with the Georgia Mass Band.
With the Georgia Mass. Yeah, we battled New Orleans.
So you in computer science. Computer science. That's what's up.
Right.
I am a software engineer myself. I have my master's in geography, so I didn't learn code in college. Like, I didn't get a computer science degree. So I deal with people who are actually the developers or people like you who actually write the code. And then I'm able to, look at it or debug it, or, I try to do my thing like that. So that's really cool that you're doing that, because that's a really, really good field. That really pays off. And I was going to tell you, after you said, after so many months after trying to get into the field, I mean, that works for everybody. It's a small percentage of people that go right into their field after college. That's good that, you had that waiting period. It's just... That just make a man out of you. You know what I'm saying? That's really all it is.
Definitely keep you humble.
Yeah, man. After I finished my master's degree, I was had a delivery at Papa John's. I had a paper route. Like, I was delivering the paper. Yeah, the Tennessean. I would get up early in the morning and do the Tennessean. And I worked at BP. There was like this little cafe inside the gas station of the BP called the Wild Bean Cafe. So I worked there too. So I had those three off jobs, and I did that for 9 months after, with a master's degree. So, I mean, that's just normal. and a lot of people have told me that I was lucky that I was only doing that for 9 months, Because some folks said that, man, that like that's like years before they got into their field. So
definitely.
Yeah, man. I just want to let you know that was normal for you, man.
Yeah, I was thankful to have that opportunity to go on tour. Right. In the between time, though, that was a blessing.
Right, right. The universe just worked it out for you. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely.
Right. So that's what's up. So I was going to tell you, congratulations with the degree. Computer science is a real good degree. You had a lot of your classes in the, is it still the NSB building?
Yeah, the engineering building.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
And John A. Peoples.
Right. Okay. What was your most memorable experience there being with Drumline Live?
Shoot, man. We were in California for about a month. And we went to Vegas for a week. Vegas was awesome. The crowd loved us in Vegas. Man, we were there in Vegas for a whole week. That was probably the most. That was my actually first time, you know, being in Vegas. Of course, we went with the Boom, but that was more of a work trip. So
right.
Had a little more downtime this go around, and really got to get out and see some sights and enjoy myself. So that was probably something that I'll definitely remember. Had some guys I went to high school with that was on tour with me, and you know, some guys I knew from back in. Like high school band camps back in high school was on tour, and we had a ball. We really did.
That's cool, man. So, yeah, Vegas is just like 3 hours for me. So it's not that bad. I've been a couple times. I've been there partying one time. Like you say, like I've been there kind of like working and all that stuff. But it's a good experience. I'm glad that you got to go.
Yeah, definitely.
And I'm glad that you got to be there a whole week. So where did you guys stay and all of that?
Stayed at the SLS. Hotel in Vegas.
Okay.
It was real nice hotel.
Real quick, this dude at Johnson C. Smith that I was with, I think he was the, I don't know if he's still there, but I think he's the chef there. He is the chef there, and he's from New York, but he played bass drum, so he was in the band with me, man. So that's crazy. So he might have been out there when you were there.
I might have.
Yeah.
Yeah, I definitely had some of the food in the hotel. The food was awesome.
Now you come back home. And you bring up the Georgia Mass Band. Tell us about that, because I'm actually starting, I want to start interviewing some folks and talking to some folks about the Mass Bands. And I've been noticing it for the last couple of years now. I haven't actually been to a performance or checked out the tape on them. But I wanted to get your take on your experiences and what you think about it. Because I've even heard, like, y'all got some haters, too. It's
man,
like
it's,
some
it's,
mass
it's been a,
band haters out there.
Yeah, it's been a big debate going on this summer. And my phone was blowing up off the hook about it. So me and my Crab Brothers, being the Boom, myself, Marcus Cummings, Antonio Alexander, and Matthew Bugs, you know, Georgia hasn't had an all-star band in a little while. But we see our friends over in Mississippi having a good time, you know, over the summer, keeping their chops fresh. We see our people over in New Orleans having a good time. We need to stop playing around and get our folks together and make it happen in Georgia. There's so many musicians here. And so last year we decided to go ahead and create a new group. It started off as the Atlanta Mass Band. And, you know, we had about 20 to 30 people that joined, and we traveled to Augusta and had a battle and did a parade. And it was a good start. It was rough. Got a lot of flack about starting it. A lot of people not too fond of the swag style or the Jackson State style, as they call it. But man, we just said, forget it, man. We out here having fun, something positive. It definitely kept us busy and kept us occupied during the summer. You know, there's like a million and one things, other things we could have been doing. But, you know, we were at band practice, you know, come home tired, go to sleep, wake up, do it all again the next day. We write all the music. We direct the band. Then I was all the trips, definitely a huge learning experience. You know, a lot of stuff that we had to go through to get it started and to organize it and keep it going that you don't necessarily learn in college. And I think it was an amazing opportunity, especially for the guys that are like music majors who, you know, are about to have their own programs. And so fast forward to this year, man, we put the word out, got a location. Man, over 100 people showed up, and we were just like overwhelmed with the support, and you know, definitely appreciate it. And the rest was history. We decided to change the name to Georgia Mass Band actually because there were literally people traveling from, not sure if you're too familiar with the state of Georgia, but people were traveling from Augusta, from Macon, I had some people travel from Augusta, people traveling from North Georgia just to come and perform with Atlanta. So to make it more inclusive, we just called it Georgia Mass Band, since we had all these other folks coming. And, you know, we wanted to include everybody. Man, had a heck of a summer, had a lot of fun, traveled to Montgomery on two big charter buses. Yeah, man, it was a lot of fun. Appreciate the support. So the current debate that's going on right now is whether these mass bands or these all-star bands are hurting the students. I don't think so. I can't think of any case where a student came to mass band and went back to their program and were just trash. Most times, if they come to us like that, pull them to the side and give them some private lessons. Be like, hey, man, this is what you should do. And, you know, that's the aspect I don't think people see. People think we just get in front of the band and yell, crank up. No, that's not how you create a band. And, you know, anybody knows that. And you can look at the clips and see we only had 12 days of rehearsal total this summer. We were able to get a pretty good product, in my opinion. It's the same fundamentals. You went to Jackson State. You know we don't just put our horns to our face and blow as hard as we can. It's a process. You do your lip slurs, your long tones. You know, you develop that tone. You develop that volume. Develop that aggression and that energy. It's a lot deeper than that. And, you know, a lot of folks just might not understand the style. And so we invite people out to rehearsals, like, come check us out. Come see what we're doing. And the people that have come call me and be like, hey, man, love what y'all doing, man. We're getting band director offers and stuff off of the simple fact that we out here having fun doing what we love to do. I don't see the issue with it. A lot of people are scared that it'll ruin their programs. And I just, you know, we practice for 12 days and you got these people, these adults and these children. You have them for a whole year. You handling your business and you don't have nothing to worry about. And, you know, of course, we're going to take care of them.
So, yeah, so break some of this down to me. You said the students. Now, the mass band, is it open to anyone, including students who are currently in the band program?
The Georgia Mass Band is geared towards adults and college students. There's a high school group called Band of Champions, and they're a high school all-star band. And, you know, they focus more so on fundamentals and development. What we're doing is more so for us, for people who are going back to Jackson State and Southern and Alabama State. And, you know, we trying to keep our chops fresh so we'll be ready for the fall. So the way we play and, you know, the things that we do, learning 20 to 30 songs in a few weeks, that's all getting us ready to go back to college for the most part. It is open to anybody, parental approval, but, you know, we do strictly enforce 18 and older participate.
So in Georgia Mass Band, it might be somebody that march in the boom, and it might be somebody that marches at Clark, and they're in the same band. They're together for that summer.
Right.
Okay, right. Cool. So I didn't know that. Now, do you know if all the other states are like that?
Like, yeah, for the most part, they are. Okay. You know, people from, like, you go to college, and everybody's repping their city or whatever. So when we go home, that's our chance to have pride at where we come from and, you know, get with our people that we might have grew up with, just we know from the area, and get together and represent where we're from.
So I definitely believe there's a lot of positives in that. You described a lot of them. There's an article that I saw posted, and I need to read that article. But just,
yeah, I know exactly what article you're talking about.
Yeah, so I'm guessing in my mind they're talking about, again, the same debate where it comes to who's cranking and who's loud, who's powerful. And, of course, I'm speculating here, you know what I'm saying, but trying to learn more musicality, or, let's say, do more concert band things or something like that. I'm feeling that that's where the rhetoric is going. Like you said, like they're trying to hurt the other programs. I know that some directors, even experiencing, you know, some of that out here in California, they feel like if you join a community band or you try to do something where it's like, you know, part of something, you lose some of your style or you lose some of the style that they're trying to teach.
Double Time Entertainment. Our passion is music and promoting HBCU marching bands as well as high school marching bands through high quality movie videos and photos. We have worked with BET, Yamaha, Ludwig, Honda Motor Company, and been featured on CNN and Lifetime Network's series, Bama State Style. We also help and orchestrate Battle of the Bands with marketing and promotions, and also became the official media team for the Queen City Battle of the Bands in Charlotte, North Carolina. Join Double Time Entertainment on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube, and now new on Periscope. Music lovers are noteworthy.
Hi, this is Thaddeus Dixon, crab of 1994 from that famous sonic boom of the South, class of 2000 from the Jackson State University. And guess what? You're chopping it up with the Marching Podcast Network.
We're back, everyone. What I remember most from the third segment is about Drumline Live and how super cool that was that he got an opportunity to be a part of that. I also told him that in the interview, a lot of folks did not hop right into a job after college, and there was some time that humbles you until you get your career going. But as they say, funny how the universe works. During that time, he was able to march and travel with Drumline Live. And I remember him checking in on all these cities on Facebook, and it looks like he got a really good experience. He also then gets into the mass bands, which has picked up a lot of momentum over the past couple of years and picked up some criticism over the past couple of years as well. There is a debate on if these bands are helping our craft or are they hurting our craft. For the listeners that don't know about the off-season for bandsmen, your director wants you to keep playing on your horn and avoid layoff periods. So you don't come back to band camp out of shape and trying to reclaim what you're doing and maybe get all excited and then play out of tune or hurt yourself or worse. You also want to try to get better because at a big program, especially like at Jackson State, you could be exposed to a freshman that comes in better than you. And it's hard to call them crab when they're actually doing their thing and they're outplaying you. So you want to do your best to keep up on your horn. The debate comes from the thought that the concert band makes your program. And that is true. You always want to play under control and with as much as musicality as possible, which is what concert band or symphonic band teaches you, versus playing marching band style in the off season because there's more blowing, more excitement. You're actually playing louder than usual. In addition, some of the type of songs you're playing, marching band songs or pop tunes or songs like that, might not be as difficult as playing your concert or your symphonic pieces. So there's some of that skill that you want to develop in the off season as well. So Elijah addressed this issue, and we'll talk about this more on the network in the future podcast. I personally myself like the fact that the students are bonding with each other across schools. And I also thought it was cool that the students are actually organizing these events on their own, building leadership skills and working and getting the experience of administration and setting up these events. Now they're getting exposure to work in the front office or to do things very similar to our ADs are doing at our colleges. So I think that there is some positive things out there. Like I said, we'll continue the discussion in the future. In our fourth and final segment, we talk about the debate with mass bands and if this is hurting the craft. He also goes into more detail about how mass bands work and what the Georgia mass band goes through versus other mass bands in the South. Finally, he tells us his most memorable experience there with the mass band and how this changes the game for the Battle of the Bands. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at marchingpodcast, or follow our blog, blog4.themarchingpodcast.com.
My take on that, and that's an interesting argument. Being from SWD, a lot of people know us as like FAMU-style school or right. Heavily FAMU-based and right. FAMU directors, and that's our style. That's how we play. Just for me, going from SWD to going to Jackson State was a huge leap for me. Did that make me a worse musician? Absolutely not. You know, I went to Jackson State, got a different style, saw some different people, and was exposed to some different teaching. And, you know, I believe development growth as a student or, you know, whatever you decide to do is all about exposure. The more that you're exposed to, I feel like the more you have to choose from. It's like, you know, you playing jazz. If all you playing is Miles Davis, So What, for the most part, that's how your style is going to be. Most of everything you play is probably going to be in that style. But, you know, you can also pick up some Clifford Brown and, you know, learn Joy Spring and stuff like that. Now you have all this different stuff to choose from and different stuff to pull from. And that just makes you so much more versatile and deadly and makes you really ready for any situation. So, I mean, the few weeks that people have to come and maybe see a different style, you know, a lot of people were interested because the guys in charge were from Jackson State. And a lot of people, you know, like Jackson State, and it was like, man, let me see what these Jackson State guys talking about. A lot of them tell me, man, I learned so much from y'all. This is very different from what I'm used to, but I like it. It's definitely making me better, helping me see some things differently. And I think that's probably one of the most important things, that when we get together, and just like you said, you know, I go to Jackson State, and I'm sitting next to a guy from Clark Atlanta. Our bands are completely different. But nonetheless, his band director has told him something I've never heard before. So at that point, now I'm learning from him, and I'm going to go back to Jackson State, or I'm going to go on my gig, and I'm, you know, now I'm pulling from what I learned from the guy next to me from Clark Atlanta, you know. And I think, personally, I just think that's a beautiful thing, that unity.
Yeah, well, that's one thing that I think is cool. Like you said, it's the unity, and then you learning something, or you even just bonding with someone else. Definitely, I think that helps. That's an interesting debate, because like you said, it's, you become more versatile or you learn more things. That rolls into my next question. You said 12 days. Are you saying that the mass band thing is only just for 12 days? Like, how long does the actual participation take place?
That's the amount of time that we had allotted to rehearse due to our location and where we were practicing at. But most mass bands are only active for maybe like a month or a month and a half in the summertime. Yeah, there's some things you can see, but, you know, there's not many bad habits you can pick up in that little amount of time. And we only practice 2 hours a day. So you think we practice 12 days, that's only 24 hours of practice. I'm not about to move my armature to the side of my face in 12 days.
Right.
You know, that's, I haven't even seen any specific examples of how that's even possible. We're reinforcing those concepts. We see bad amateurs, hey, man, you should do this or you should do that. Hey, man, forget everything you learned. No, use everything you learned to produce this sound. That's what makes bands great. Everything that your band director is teaching you, hopefully everything your band director is teaching you is going to help you contribute to the ensemble in a positive way. Most bands go for about a month and a half or so, tops. And at that point, we're done for the summer and typically have like a month off for band camp or pre-drill starts with their own programs. They're with their own school for a whole nother year, learning the ways and the foundations of their band directors.
Is it like a certain date that all the mass bands across all states start? Or how does it get started, so to speak?
It varies from place to place. Culture in different states or cities are different. In Atlanta, typically, we don't get started with these activities until after the school year is over. Because, you know, a lot of bands in Atlanta are active the way up until the last day of school. But, you know, places like Jackson with the Mississippi All-Star Band, you know, they typically start maybe like a week before Jackson State gets out of school. They have access to the facilities and maybe not be as active towards the end of the year. So it varies. Really, man, you just find a location, pick a start date, and whoever shows up, man, that's who you rock with.
So do someone from each band, representing each band, do they call another band to do a battle? Do you guys, like, look for parades to do? Like, how do you know specifically, like, what's on the itinerary for the summer?
Plan in advance. I know this year we planned about 4 months in advance. We booked a few parades. We booked the battle in Montgomery against the River Region All-Star Band. The real big, like, I guess you can say, the All-Star Band Championship in Jackson, Mississippi. Independent Showdown in Jackson, Mississippi. That's where all the bands come and meet up at to see who's running what. Basically, you know, you book it in advance and, you know, make the phone calls to the other All-Star Band directors or the coordinators of these parades or events, or, you know, you even put on your own event. But yeah, it's a lot. It's a lot that's can be done the summertime, so the schools aren't active during the summer. So all-star bands, that gives us a little more leeway to go out and do a little bit more as well.
Do people pay dues? How do they become a part of the mass band? Because I'm sure that, you know, you need donations or some type of funding to do a lot of this stuff. So how does, like, one join, and, like, what's the criteria or whatnot?
Show up, get the information, fill out some forms, information forms, all that stuff, and we add you to the roster. Our dues are only $35. You know, that covers your T-shirt and trips and stuff for the summer. And, yeah, man, once you get that squared away, you learn music and you in there, man.
Is it $35 for the year or for that summer session?
For that summer in particular.
Okay, okay, okay. All right, yeah, man, that's not bad. That's not bad. That's what's up, man. Okay.
Yeah.
So you did that. What would you say was your most memorable experience so far in your years participating with the Mass Band?
My most memorable is just, man, getting back this summer after only having about 20 to 30 members last year and coming back this summer. This summer went by a lot smoother. We didn't have as many issues with securing a location or getting support. And, man, it was an overwhelming feeling when we got back that first day, getting in front of the band and warm the band up, and it's people piling in through the door. And I'm just like, man, wow. Like, you know, we came a long way from just 1 year ago. And that was, honestly, man, it just, this whole summer has been an experience. That virtual battle was pretty revolutionary. It had never been done before.
Yeah, that's
so
my
I'm
next
definitely
question.
Proud of that.
That's my that was actually Got my about. Next question. So yeah, so
yeah.
What is that? Could you explain to us what that is and just break that down? What
yeah.
happened?
Yeah, virtual battle. Two bands that probably can't meet face to face. These trips are expensive. To travel from Georgia to New Orleans is pretty expensive. Instead of doing that, to save both bands money, get our people together at rehearsal, set up some cameras, and went live on Facebook Live from my phone, actually. Facebook has a new feature where it's almost like FaceTime, where you can, like, add another person to your live feed in a little box to your live feed. And so we were both on Facebook Live together. Our band played a song. New Orleans played a song back. And, you know, we're just going back and forth. And the whole time, people are commenting real time, as well as sharing the video. So we basically just battled remotely online.
So basically you were just playing to the Facebook Live, and were you seeing another band respond, or it was just basically just posting performance?
So after we played, they heard what we played, then they played, and so we heard what they played, and, you know, it was like an actual battle, like an actual fifth quarter battle going back and forth, except we're not in the same exact place.
How was the band able to see the other, like, did you guys have, like, a big projector screen or something?
Nah, the staff basically controlled the flow of the battle. Of course, some of the band might have been in the stands watching it on their phones as it was going on. Yeah. We controlled the flow of it. So the whole time we were watching them and listening to what they were playing. From there, we decided on what we were going to play. And when they finished, then we go ahead, we struck it up.
Because definitely, again, yeah, it's something for folks like me. We could actually see it because we not there, or now we're talking about the fact because so much has come up with, like, funding, and this definitely eliminates a lot of that. A lot of that travel,
yeah,
so to speak. So that's what's up, man, that you were a part of that. So I definitely would like. And who did you guys battle? You said New Orleans?
Yeah, New Orleans All-Star Band.
Okay, okay. That's what's up, man. I had to check that out.
If you don't want the raw experience of the live virtual battle, you can watch the HD version on YouTube.
Okay. Okay. Okay, man. That's what's up, man. Well, man, we get to the end of the interview, man. Is there anything else that you wanted to wrap up in this beta style 2.0 version of the interview?
Yeah, man. I just really want to give a shout out to all the band heads out there, man. The culture, everything we do is for the culture, man, and everything we doing out here is for the love of music, and, you know, for the love of band, you know, the stuff we've been doing mostly our whole lives, man. Let's keep the culture alive, man, and let's continue to support each other and work together, and, you know, nothing but positive can come from all this. Enjoy yourself, whatever you decide to do with your summer. That's what you decide to do. Nobody's against it. Nobody's opposed to it. Just have fun, man, and let's continue to just keep the music alive, because they're taking music out of the schools and stuff like that. Last thing we need is for us to be beefing amongst each other, make it even easier. You know what I'm saying? So let's just keep the culture alive, man, and keep doing what we're doing. And all the educators, man, keep doing a great job and taking care of your students and taking care of your programs. And for us guys over the summer, we're going to continue to give your students and our best, so there's nothing that you have to worry about.
That's what's up, man. And also, last thing real quick, you usually have locks.
You had locks
for a while. Did you cut your hair off, man?
Yeah, man. Yeah, I did.
So how long did you have your hair? How long were you growing your hair?
I had my locks for 15 years.
Whoa.
I started when I was in third grade, yeah.
Wow. So what made you cut them off?
And I just felt like it. You know, I was just ready for a change, honestly. It was nothing, no major breakthrough or spiritual experience. I just kind of was ready to let them go.
I heard
something new.
I mean, is it like a big adjustment?
My head is cold. Man, I'm getting adjusted. I'm trying to get this wave thing started, you know, so I didn't call my peoples, you know, they told me what wave grease and brush to get, and, you know, I've been rocking my do-rag around the house. Yeah, man, it's been cool, man. It's definitely a different experience, but it was a change I was ready for, so I'm happy about it.
We're back, everyone. If you're interested in becoming a sponsor or a patron to the Marching Podcast, please contact the show and we'll give you the criteria so we can start to pub your business using our platform. We'll play your commercial, we'll post your website on our blog, and we'll help send out your information through social media. So contact us so we can help build your business. What I recall from the last segment is about the virtual battle. This is, again, something that I like, where the students are in control and they have the ingenuity to overcome an obstacle, and they can say that they were the first ones that started something new. Our students are innovators and able to create the best thing out of a barrier, which is travel and the expenses involved with travel and the insurance protecting the students, et cetera, et cetera. I'm sure it's a lot, but they've overcome this by getting on Facebook Live and having a battle, and the band does not have to be in front of you. This is adding on to the craft and adding a new wrinkle into our battle of the bands. They have dues so they can support. They have a support system with their organization, and I really appreciate what they're doing. So shout out to the Mass Bands, and shout out to Elijah, the young Trump Funk, Crab of 2012, and good luck to you in your future endeavors, and thank you for your time on the interview.
This is Chris Jones, owner, creator, and founder of March Aerobics. I'm just chopping it up with the Marching Podcast Network. Now get your sticks running.
Hi, this is David McFadden, Jackson State University graduate, Sonic Boom, Trump Funk, Panther 97. You are listening to Choppin' It Up here on the Marching Podcast Network.
Hi, this is Thaddeus Dixon, Crab of 1994 from that famous Sonic Boom of the South, class of 2000 from the Jackson State University. And guess what? You're chopping it up with the Marching Podcast Network.
That's all the time we have for our podcast. Check out the website and donate what's in your heart to themarchingpodcast.com. Like us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. Thanks to you for listening. And remember, the eye is a better pupil and more willing than the ear. Advice may be misleading, but examples are always clear. See you next time.